Good morning, everybody. It's Saturday, June 19th. It's Juneteenth. Happy Juneteenth. It's Tana from Bridge to Health New Mexico and the Española Fitness Studio coming to you here from my office at 628 Riverside Drive. Stop in anytime and check us out. We have lots of stuff going on. Hope you guys are having a beautiful Saturday. Today, we're going to do our 1 hour presentation on weight gain during the COVID-19 pandemic shutdowns. So I realize I'm a little out of order. I did the hormone one when I was supposed to do the virus one. So I got my biology a little mixed up there. So forgive the out of order. I just want to be sure you get all the information that we've promised you with this great session through your Health and Human Services Department. Any questions that you have about anything that I present, be sure to email me director@bridgetohealthnmexico.org or call 505-591-4200 or comment here if you're live here with me on Zoom. Go ahead and show your face. If you're on YouTube, go ahead and comment underneath. All right, guys, I'm going to share my screen with you now. And we're going to talk about weight gain during COVID-19 pandemic. You're not alone. You gained weight during the pandemic. All right, here we are. I'll come back to see you at the end of the presentation so you can see my slides. Okay, weight gain during the pandemic. First, I want you to notice, this is the coronavirus, of course. We all got used to seeing its picture everywhere in 2020 and the beginning of 2021. I want you to notice it's a big round ball, just like your tummy got over 2020. So we're going to talk about why that happens. Weight gain during the pandemic is sometimes called the quarantine 15, just like the freshman 15. If you go to college, you're notorious for gaining 15 pounds that first year of school. This is the quarantine 15. It's also called the COVID-19, the 19 pounds people gained during shutdowns at home. I want you to know you're not alone if you experience this. I have to tell you, I know of only one person who lost weight during 2020. The rest of the people who have spoken to me about it or people in my life gained weight. So you're definitely not alone. The average American gained 2 pounds per month during 2020 for a total of 24 pounds gained that they're struggling now to lose. That was between March of 2020 and March of 2021. As you know, this was the most intense shutdown period. I have a son who turned 15 in March of 2020 and 16 in March of 2021. So he was 15 for the entire shutdown period, and he calls it his COVIDieta or his coronieta. Why did this happen? Why did we gain weight during COVID-19? As a health educator, I find it really fascinating because it was the perfect storm for weight gain. When we talk about the psychology, the biology, and the environmental factors that go into us gaining weight, being shut down between March 2020 and March 2021 was the perfect storm. That's what I'm going to explain to you today. Oh, looks like we're going through extra little pokes. That's okay. Okay, what's the first reason? First of all, I'm going to cover 9 reasons with you today. And I hope you understanding the reasons that you gained weight during this shutdown period will help you understand why you're gaining weight during non-shutdown periods. The psychology, the biology, and the environmental cues are all the same. It's just that they were intensified during this particular time. The first reason is fear of scarcity. Our brains are created to keep us alive. That's their job. They need to make sure we have enough energy, we have enough fuel to live. Parts of our brain, like the hypothalamus, are ancient. They are the animal part of our brain. And they haven't really caught up to modern day. So if our hypothalamus thinks that we are starving or might be in danger of starving, it slows down our metabolism. Metabolism is the rate that we burn energy at rest just to keep our bodily functions going. So it slows down our metabolism. It increases our attraction to high energy food. That would be carbohydrate, high calorie, high fat foods that are more likely to keep us alive. And it wants to store that energy as fat so that it's protecting our body to not starve in the future. When the pandemic hit in March of 2020, think back to what was happening in the grocery stores. There were empty shelves. People were hoarding food and supplies. We didn't know if the supply chains for food and supplies were going to get disturbed and we weren't going to have access to things that we felt that we needed. We were watching news reports and pictures of lines to get food. What this did to our brain is that it sent a message saying, whoa, we need to go into survival mode and pretend that we're going to be starving. Now, many of us, I will go out on a limb and say most of us, we're not actually going to starve or actually have a scarcity of anything in March of 2020. But we felt like we may. So our brain panicked and decided that it needed to protect our body at all costs. So we're going to spend some time in a presentation in the next few months talking about the brain and the neuroscience of eating. And you'll see that fear of scarcity does a number on your body. So that's the first thing that happened in 2020. We thought we were going to starve and not have any food or supplies available to us. The second thing that happened is that after we hoarded all those high carbohydrate, high fat, high energy foods in our pantries, we were then shut in with that food. Going back to the ancient part of our brain, when we are around food, our brain wants to eat it. And that's because the hypothalamus believes that we are all still hunter-gatherers. Some of you might be hunter-gatherers, but I'm going to go out on a limb and say most of you are probably not. Most of you have different types of jobs now that bring in money that allow you to buy food. You're not going out and hunting or gathering for your dinner each night. But the hypothalamus believes that we're still hunter-gatherers. So when we have food, we need to eat it because we may not have food tomorrow. So when we are shut in, literally, we didn't know if we could go out. It wasn't safe to go out. You remember when we weren't even taking walks outside at the beginning of the pandemic because we were not sure what was safe. And of course, that's especially true for people who live in cities. You guys who live in the country probably felt more comfortable more quickly because you have more space around you. But being shut in with all that food sent messages to your brain to eat. The third reason why we gained weight during the pandemic is that we had a lot of time on our hands. Many of you started to work from home. Some of you were laid off and didn't have jobs. Many of you didn't have a commute, either to bring kids to school or to childcare. So you suddenly had more time, which, if you remember, in March 2020, a lot of people started gardening, started picking up hobbies, started spending more time with family. Lots of positive things came out of the pandemic shutdown, extra time phenomenon. But one negative thing that happened is that we ate more. We eat for so many reasons, and this is something that we need to get under control if we're trying to manage or lose weight. We need to think of food as fuel. Food is like the gas that you put in your car. But we don't treat it like fuel. If we think of our bodies like a car, we stop at the gas station. If the car needs windshield wiper fluids, we put gas in it. If the car needs a car wash, we put gas in it. If the car has a flat tire, we put gas in it. And that doesn't really make sense, does it? Would you do that for your car? No, you'd be wasting money on gas. The gas would be spilling out of the tank onto the ground, overflowing because it's already full of gas. But that's what we do with our bodies. We keep putting fuel in, even if the tank is full, because we eat when we're bored. We eat when we're angry. We eat when we're happy. We eat when we're celebrating. We eat to show people we love them and they love us. We eat all the time for so many different reasons. And so during the shutdown, having more time on our hands meant more boredom. It meant not knowing what to do with that time. It meant enjoying that time, or it meant being irritated with people around us and eating during that time. So having more time on our hands led us to gain weight because we were eating more. You may have also been cooking more. This is a really positive thing from the shutdown. If you were somebody who went out to eat a lot before, you may have found that you were cooking at home more, which is a beautiful thing. But maybe that meant that you were eating more. Now, it was probably healthier food than what you were getting if you were going out a lot, but you were still probably eating more. Okay, so we've learned that fear of scarcity, being shut in with lots of food and having a lot of time on our hands affected our weight during the pandemic shutdown. What's the next reason? Ooh, stress. Yes, stress. There was a lot of stress during March of 2020 to March of 2021. Even if your job wasn't affected and your family was healthy, you were still experiencing stress. And for you guys whose jobs were affected, whose livelihoods were affected, whose friends and families got sick or even passed away, there was a lot of stress. When we get stressed, our body releases stress hormones. We talked about hormones last week and the week before. So if you want more about hormones, go back to those sessions. But stress hormones like adrenaline, like cortisol, are released in the body and they send messages to the brain, holy cow, go into fight or flight mode. We need to survive. Again, the brain's job is to keep you alive. So under stress, the brain changes the functions of the body to be able to fight or run. During the shutdown, you probably didn't fight and you probably didn't run, but the old part of your brain believes those are the only options. you probably sat at a computer and tried to figure out grants and unemployment and sources of money that you could get if you had lost your job. You probably spent a lot of time on the phone with friends and family and work and children, talking about the pandemic, talking about the changes in your life, talking about stress. All those things are stress. So your hormone, your stress hormones are high, sending a message to your brain. It either has to fight or flight. But you're sitting. What that means is that your brain has prepared the body for activity under stress, because that's what we used to do when we were cavemen. We're no longer cavemen, but the brain doesn't know that yet. And so it's raised the stress hormones, it's slowed down the metabolism, it's raised the heart rate, it's ready to fight, and you're then sitting at a computer. What that does is makes your body hold on to fat and weight. Okay, so the fourth reason you gained weight, just like most other people during the pandemic, is stress. The next reason is that we needed soothing. We needed comfort. We needed things that reminded us of the times before, right? We get a lot of comfort from food. Comfort food is called comfort food for a reason, right? We all have different comfort foods, but there's some really interesting research that suggests that your comfort food is something that your mom or a positive caregiver in your life, when you were a child, used to make to soothe you. So for me, for example, it's the smell of cooking tomato sauce. My mom is Italian. And so when she would cook, the whole house would smell like Italian tomato sauce. So when I'm stressed, that smell and that taste is very, very soothing to me. It might not be tomato sauce for you. It might be something else. It can be helpful to think back to your childhood and what food smells, taste, sensations, timings soothed you and comforted you as a child. You may have found that those were the foods that you craved from March 2020 to March 2021 because you needed to be soothed. Go ahead and comment what your soothing foods were. I think that's super interesting depending on the family. Reason number six we gained weight during the pandemic was that there was a lack of normal emotional outlets. Going back to stress and a need for soothing. Before the pandemic, when you were stressed, you may have gone out for a run, for a drink, for time with friends, to visit family. You may have taken a trip, a drive, or an airplane trip, or a train trip, or a bike ride, something. You would have gone out and you would have met with people often. We couldn't do that during the shutdown. That was taken away from us. So the only thing, one of the only things that we had as an emotional outlet was eating and watching screens. I want you to raise your hand by yourself there, wherever you happen to be watching. If you binge watched more TV, Netflix, Hulu, whatever you binge on during the pandemic, I would imagine most of us did, right? Partly as an emotional outlet. It was a way to get away from reality, similar to taking a trip, going out with friends, having a drink, visiting family can be during normal times. We didn't have that, so we sat and watched screens and ate comfort food. We didn't have other things to do. Even going to a counselor or a doctor to talk about your emotional stresses, that was also taken away at the beginning. Everything was closed down. The doctors and healthcare providers, they were asking us not to come in unless it was an emergency. Do you remember? So maybe you usually go to counseling and you couldn't do that at the beginning of the pandemic. So you ate and you sat and you stressed. Number seven is our eating and sitting habits with our family. Again, one of the positive things about the pandemic shutdown was the fact that we had more time together with people who we live in the same households with. This was a beautiful thing and frankly, a not so beautiful thing, right? Even if you really like the people you live with, it was an awful large dose of them, right? I live with two teenage boys and a husband. I love and adore them, but it was a lot of testosterone in the house with three men and just me. I'm so grateful for my chickens because they're all females. They're the only females we have in the house. So maybe you can relate. Habits with our family can be very positive and healthy, or a bit unhealthy. I know for my family, we have a tendency to eat ice cream together as desserts after dinner on special weekend occasions. It's a special, fun, beautiful tradition that we really enjoy. But during the pandemic, we were eating ice cream every night, not just on the weekends, because we were all together. There was no basketball practice. There was no track practice. There was no soccer. There were no friends' houses to be at. The whole family was home all the time. So our habit of eating ice cream to celebrate a weekend night was suddenly happening every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Maybe watching a movie is a habit you have with your family, sitting. There were a few positive things that came out with all that time with family. Maybe you found you were hiking more. Maybe you found you were taking walks more together. That's great. But the truth is, as a country, as a world, by the way, this is not just American. This was happening, the weight gain during the pandemic happened all over the world. So your habits with your family, around eating and around sitting, were exacerbated during the shutdown. The other thing that happened was that people were cooking a lot more. And because the whole family was around, we were cooking things that the whole family likes to eat. If you're somebody who likes to eat tons of vegetables and salads and you're okay with cold food every day, that can be hard to do for a whole family. Usually. That's the kind of thing that we make when we're eating by ourselves or when we're taking a lunch to work. When we eat with the family, it tends to be larger, hotter, more carbohydrate, higher fat meals. Our traditional family meals are not cold salads most of the time, at least for dinner. So we have habits around what we eat as a family, how we eat it. Also, just the phrase family style is when you bring the whole pot of food to the table, right? When you do that, evidence shows you will eat more because the whole plate is in front of you and you can continue to serve. Going back to the brain wanting to eat when food is around. Gluttony is something that saved us when we were cavemen and women. Now it's killing us. So when we eat alone at work or grabbing breakfast on the run, we used to do that at least two meals a day and have one meal a day with the family, if we're lucky, usually dinner. During shutdown, we had three meals a day all together, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And we found those meals were higher calorie, higher carbohydrate, and higher serving sizes because people were eating family style. So seventh reason, habits with family. You can see how it's all coming together, right? The perfect storm for weight gain. Reason number eight is difficulty exercising. The fitness industry has been telling you for years and years and years and years to join a gym, to get involved in extracurricular activities that move your body, to involve your children in sports and extracurricular activities that move your body. We've been telling you to exercise with a buddy, with a group, all these things that work really, really, really well when you're not in a pandemic. But during the pandemic, we couldn't do any of those things. All the gyms closed. We were not able to walk with our friends or family. Our children's sports and activity, extracurricular activities were all shut down. So many of us had a hard time translating how we were going to exercise and move our bodies now that we weren't able to do all the things that the fitness industry had been telling us to do. Be social about your exercise. Now, for those of you who were already solo rock climbers and solo bikers and marathon runners out there by yourself, you guys had this under control. But for the rest of us, it was hard. If your exercise is taking a Zumba class or a yoga class in a room with a lot of other people in close proximity, breathing hard to loud music, that was suddenly taken away. It was much harder for us to figure out how to exercise alone. Also, many people find it harder to work their bodies intensely if they don't have somebody else pushing them. Working out by yourself, when you hit a point of discomfort, we have a tendency to stop. But if we're working out with a group or with an instructor who can see us, that's an important phrase there, because if we're working out online with a YouTube video or with this program, instructor can't see you, so you have a tendency to stop at the first sign of discomfort. And in order to really exercise, we do have to get uncomfortable. We do have to push our bodies past our point of comfort. Now, you really need to get smart about the difference between pain and discomfort, and that's something an instructor can help you with. Let me know if you want help with that. But when we're working out by ourselves, we have a tendency to give up too quickly. And so it was hard for us to figure out what to do exercising and then to do it in a way that really did make a difference to our body and our health and our mind. The last reason, I love this last reason. This is actually a new one since I gave the last, the 30-minute presentation on this topic. I love this one so much. The ninth reason why we gained weight during the pandemic was that we are beautiful, community-minded, supportive people, and we wanted to save the restaurants. This is so awesome. As a small business owner during the pandemic, I will tell you, I really appreciate this one, and I definitely did this one too. We knew our restaurants were in trouble. And we knew they needed our support, our help. So when our restaurants opened up for takeout, we went kind of crazy supporting them, which is beautiful, but it wasn't that great for our waistline, right? So whereas before the pandemic, I never went out to lunch. I always brought my salad from home. I have a tendency to work through the lunch hour, so the thought of taking time to go out to a restaurant was never attractive to me on a work day. But during the pandemic, I felt like the restaurants around my studio needed my help. And so I started going out to lunch. I have food trucks and Italian food and New Mexican food right next to the studio. So I wanted to support them. But let me tell you that the calorie, carbohydrate, and fat contents, actually, I don't care so much about the fat content, but the carbohydrate and the calorie content of my lunch multiplied exponentially because I was trying to save the restaurants. So maybe that's something you can relate to. Again, it's a beautiful thing for the community, a wonderful thing to do for your neighbor, not so good for your weight. All right, guys, so I want you to take a moment and look at this list. Think back to March 2020 to March 2021. Fear of scarcity, being shut in with lots of food, having too much time on our hands, experiencing stress, needing soothing and comfort, a lack of our normal emotional outlets being available, good and bad habits with our families, difficulty exercising, and trying to save the restaurants all came together to make us be shaped like the coronavirus, a round circle instead of flat sticks that we were before the pandemic. Okay. To finish up this presentation today, I want to spend some time talking to you about the stages of change model. And I want to talk to you about this in this particular topic because I want you to realize that our health behavior is in a constant cycle. And now that the pandemic is coming to a close, we're all getting vaccinated. By the way, you should get vaccinated if you possibly can. If you don't know how to get vaccinated, comment, call, I can help you do that. Now that the pandemic is coming to a close and things are opening up and the 9 reasons that we just talked about are starting to go away, we can jump back into the stage of change, into the change model and correct the weight gain from the pandemic. So I just want to explain the stages of change model. We enter at pre-contemplation the first time that we enter. So I want you to think about your weight gain and the fact that you might want to be losing it now. I know a lot of people are coming to me wanting to lose that quarantine 15. Before they come in and talk to me, they're in pre-contemplation. Pre-contemplation is the stage where you're not ready to tackle the health behavior change. So we were all in pre-contemplation in, let's say, last August, a year ago. We were not thinking about losing weight, probably. We were smack dab in the middle of a global pandemic. Weight was the least of our concerns. We were trying to stay alive, trying to keep our friends and family alive. At a very basic level, we were not concerned about larger issues like our waistline, no pun intended. So pre-contemplation, you're not even thinking about it. Then you move to contemplation. That's maybe how you were feeling in January of 2021. You were thinking, you know what? I can see the vaccines are coming. This pandemic is slowing down. Our kids are back at school. Maybe I'm going to start thinking about losing my quarantine 15. You're in contemplation. You're contemplating the change. The next step is moving to determination. Determination is when you say, you know what, I am going to get the phone number of Tana and I'm going to call her and set up an appointment to talk to her about what it would take to lose this weight. That's determination. The next step is action. The next step is when you take that step that you've decided to do, you've determined to do the step. So whether it's meeting with a professional or it's increasing your own exercise, decreasing your carbohydrates, increasing your vegetables, whatever your decided action is, you move into action stage when you're actually doing the work. Okay? So for those of you who are watching this session, you might be in contemplation or determination about losing weight, or maybe you're actually taking the action. Watching this presentation would not count as action towards losing weight. It would be when you take a walk later, when you take a run later, when you meet with your professional about your nutrition, your activity, your hormones, your chemistry, your psychology. That would be action. Now, guys, I want you to notice the next step after action is what? Relapse. Yes, relapse is a normal and expected part of the stages of change model. It doesn't happen all the time, but it happens most of the time. If you expect relapse, you will not be surprised when it happens. Even though it's expected and normal, it is still urgent and an emergency that needs to be dealt with immediately. Don't let your relapse last for a year. Let it last for an hour, a day, 2 days. Let it be short, okay? If we're talking about your weight, relapse may look like eating the bag of Oreo cookies because you were angry at your husband. It may look like skipping your workout because you slept through the morning alarm. Whatever the relapse is, it's urgent, it's an emergency. You need to stop it immediately and get back on the wagon as quickly as possible. But I don't want you to be surprised when you relapse. After 30 years working in the health and fitness industry, I see that the people who succeed for long-term health behavior change are not the ones who never relapse. They're the ones who get back on the wagon quickly and every time. After relapse, you move into maintenance. So maintenance, you've taken the action, you fall off the wagon, you come back on the wagon. And each time you do that, your behavior becomes more and more comfortable. For those of you who have truly changed health behavior, it might be around an addiction like smoking, opiates, alcohol, something very serious like that. Or it might be something a little bit less serious like binge watching or not exercising enough or not eating well, which of course, if you're diabetic, can be very serious. Just like the cigarette smoking. But you move into maintenance because things become easier. Your habit becomes more cemented and more formed, and you move into maintenance. Now, I do want to point out here that in this cycle that you're seeing, it looks like it just continues to go around in a circular motion. Really, during maintenance, you might move back down to relapse and then back up to maintenance. So it's not as clean as it looks in this model. And I want you to know that you can exit and re-enter at any stage. Most of the time when we relapse, we do go through at least contemplation, determination, action again. You have to go through action, but at least contemplation and determination again. So when you fall off the wagon, you do have to decide that you're going to pick yourself up from the ground and jump back on the wagon. And that would be considered contemplation and determination. But I don't want to get in the weeds too much. I like presenting the stages of change model to clients because it helps them understand that their experience is not unique. I'm sorry to tell you this if your parents told you otherwise, but you are not unique. You are human and experience most of the same things that every other human on the planet experiences. And the stages of change is one of them. Every time that we decide to change our health behavior, to be more positive, to be healthier, we will go through the stages of change model. And I find that comforting. You're not the only one who's going to relapse. You're not the only one who has to think for a long time before they determine what to do and actually take action. I will tell you that the stages in the stages of change model can happen for different lengths of time. So they could happen for a short amount of time or for a long amount of time. For some people, moving from pre-contemplation to action takes a matter of hours, right? Some people are fast. Other people, it can take years to get from pre-contemplation to action, okay? That's okay. But if you have a health issue caused by obesity, diabetes, arthritis, really anything that you need to speed things up a little bit, working with a professional can help you get through the stages of change a little bit more quickly. So if you have any questions about stages of change, go ahead and ask them if you're live here on Zoom with me or in the comments. All right, guys, now we're going to go back to Zoom. So give me a moment to stop sharing my screen. All right, I'm back with you. 9 reasons your waistline expanded during the COVID-19 shutdown. I hope it makes more sense to you now. And really what I hope is that the knowledge that you gain today is going to help you understand why you overeat when it's not a pandemic. Ask yourself, are you feeling a fear of scarcity? Is your brain fearful that there isn't going to be enough food? Are you eating for soothing? Are you eating out of habits with the family? Are you eating as a stress reaction? Or when you get stressed, are you sitting or are you moving your body? Try to move your body when you're stressed. I think we have a whole session on stress. We'll talk about that much more. Are you eating to support your neighbor or to support your local restaurant? Again, very positive for your heart, not very positive for everything else. Actually, I'll say not very positive for your heart either. Positive for your soul, not so good for your heart or your body. Then ask yourself, what stage of change are you in? The pandemic's almost over. Are you ready to lose that weight? People are really having success now that the pandemic is closing, losing weight if they're working with professionals. So I do really encourage you to get with a professional now, lose that weight. Also, if you're diabetic, really for everybody, but especially if you're diabetic, it is super important to get yourself back to your doctor. During COVID-19, many people stopped going to the doctor because they told us to at the beginning. Then they changed their message messaging a little bit and said, actually, to care for your chronic disease, we do want you to come in, but we want you to come in a safe way. So masks and longer appointments and maybe virtual visits. It's super important to take care of your chronic disease, to have your blood pressure checked, to have your A1C checked, to make sure that your feet are okay. All that regular care for your diabetes is super important to keep up, whether it's pandemic or not. So make sure you're making that appointment, getting back to your doctor now that the pandemic is closing down. And while you're there, ask them for a referral or your weight if you're really struggling with it. I can definitely help you with that. There are many other professionals in the community that can help you with that. Let us help you. I will tell you that we here at Bridge to Health New Mexico do run weight loss courses as a group 3 times a year. One in the winter that starts in January, one in the spring that starts in April, and one in the fall that starts in September. So our next session will start the first week of September. The power of the group, the power of 10 weeks of intense personal, individual, and group work on psychology, biology, sociology really is powerful for weight loss. So I want to encourage you, you can go on our website, bridgetohealthnm.org. Click on the weight loss category and you'll see information about that class. Guys, another session over. I am so grateful for you spending time with me today talking about weight gain during the COVID-19 pandemic shutdown. May we not have another pandemic for at least 100 years. So it's our children's children who have to deal with it. Sorry, guys. Everybody has had to deal with it over history, but at least you'll know what to do the next time it comes around. You guys have a beautiful weekend, and I will see you Wednesday morning. We're going to talk about sleep for half an hour. So get ready for that. Don't sleep during the session. Just learn about it and sleep after. All right, guys, have a beautiful day. Bye-bye.